3 weeks ago, we were out in the yard and we looked and we found something had been plugged into the back of the church, and I thought it belonged to some of the members who had been working on the roof and stuff, and it didn't belong to anyone and stuff. And that was about 3 weeks ago or so. And then yesterday we found out that somebody had been plugging into the power and they're living in the garden and stuff. And I guess, well, it wasn't a bad place for Jesus to be at in the garden, so I guess they thought it was a good place for them to be there as well. And they set up quite a house. They had a TV and a VCR and stuff, and so they were able to watch movies and things, and they were able to cook out in their little fire pit and stuff like that. And you know, and we don't know who it was. We evicted them today and stuff, and so if they come back, they'll have to come back with some more stuff because we took everything else they had. But it just reminds us of the times in which we're living in. Sometimes we forget about how hard and desperate things are. We don't understand what people were going through. But I was blessed when I called a brother from here at the church, Deputy Chief Rick Nichols, and I told him about it. And he says, well, you know, he says, we'll come by the church and we'll check. He says, but you know, he says, is somebody that's homeless, is somebody that needs help, you know, we're not looking to put anybody in jail. And I said, that's what we're not either. He says, if a person needs help, we're going to try to figure out then if we can catch them, we'll find out how we can help them. And that was good to know that, because hard times doesn't mean that we're crooks. They said, well, they plugged into the power. In an old building like this, we weigh so much in heat and in the winter and cool in the summer and stuff, because this building doesn't contain either one. You know, and doors open and those things there, we wouldn't even have noticed it had he not left the stuff out. But again, it just reminds us the importance of preaching and teaching the word, going out, because there's people that are living in desperate times and without hope. Without hope. And the sad part is that you got as far as the back of the church and didn't have enough heart or trust to come inside the church. Because he wouldn't have been turned away, or she wouldn't have been turned away, or they wouldn't have been turned away. But you have not because you've asked not. We serve a God, and sometimes that's how life is. We get real close, but we don't enter in. We benefit from the things that possibly God has for us. The blessings of a mother and father who preach and teach the word, blessings of those that are around you, and you get the overflow of the blessing. But it doesn't mean that you enter in. And that's what I thought about with this individual. You were that close, and yet you didn't enter in. You stealed away in the dark, but there was opportunities for you in the light. And that individual represents the world in which we live in. God is calling out for those to say, come unto me, you that are heavy laden, burdened down, and I will give you rest. And how many people are getting so close, benefiting from what God has in store, and yet will not receive the gift that will set them free forever? Let us pray. Father, we thank you tonight, Lord, that we have come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. But Lord, our hearts break, Lord, because we know there are many that are lost. Lord, and I pray that you would give us spiritual insight to recognize, Lord, those that are in need. We pray for divine appointments that you have put people in our path, that we might begin to share this hope that lies within us, to encourage those that are dealing with health issues, financial issues, relationship issues, Lord, and let them know that the struggles, the trials and tribulations of life, there's an answer to it. His name is Jesus, who can bring peace to the brokenness of a person's life, bring comfort to heal that has been hurt along the way in this life's journey. I pray tonight, dear Heavenly Father, for that person that was so close. That, Lord, if they're still in the community, bring them our way. I pray tonight, Lord, for our neighbors and those we pass along the street. There's so many people, Lord, and maybe that person, Lord, we've been passing all along and still didn't know. And so I'm asking that you would touch us in a way that we would be sensitive to needs of others. And so, Lord, I thank you tonight for who you are. You are life to us. We thank you, Lord, that you're a way maker, Lord. And I thank you, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that you are greater than anything we find ourselves facing today. And what I mean by that, Lord, is that you're God and you will comfort, you will strengthen, you will meet us right where we live, no matter what we're going through when we put our trust in you. Now, Holy Spirit, we ask that you would just continue to lead us, guide us into this evening. Open your word, Lord, and the study of your word, Lord, that we might be strengthened, Lord. We are not looking for information, Lord, but we're looking for that time that will reveal you to us, Lord, that we might grow in you. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I had done a funeral today and another one tomorrow. I was looking at the scriptures there in John, and the scriptures remind us when Thomas asked and said, Lord, how could we know the way? How can we know the way? We don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He let him know that, how long can you guys be with me and not know that when you see me, you've seen the Father? How can you come and be with me and run with me and not get this? And yet I thought about it. We as the church sometimes still don't understand. We still don't get it sometimes. That Christ has made it possible that we might grow and walk in a right relationship with a living God today. I don't want us to be people who are looking for the by and by. One day, just to hear the old folks say, I'm living this life and I'm sending up timber so that I can build my mansion in the sky. The word tells me that he said, I go to prepare a place for you. You ain't got to send up nothing. You know, you just got to put your faith and your trust in me. That we stop laboring after the things that God has not called us to. But he's calling us to be faithful in the things that he has called us to. And so as we're looking at the word tonight, and I thank God for this study that we have done in the Bible, the word of God. And we talked about how the Bible claims to be inspired by the Word of God. And we looked at those scriptures. And we knew that all scriptures was given by the inspiration of God. And it's not by human thoughts, man's ideas. Man could not sit down and begin to write a thought of God anytime, anyway. Couldn't do it. Couldn't do it. It would be so complex for us to understand the truth of just going another mile, turning the cheek, forgiving them that have done you wrong. I can't see a man saying that. That he comes up with a great idea and says, I'm going to give you a teaching. When people do you wrong, forgive them. And if they slap you on the cheek, turn the other one and let them have that. And if they take the shirt off your back, give them your coat also. And they would run that person out on a rail and tell them they're as crazy as a June bug, you know? But when God tells us, it's still difficult. But when we begin to take those steps of faith according to the Word of God, our lives begin to change. And something begins to stir inside of us and says, there has to be a God. Because this goes against everything that is in me. And yet I know it is so right. And I thank God tonight, for that's what God does for us. He lets man understand that we can have this relationship with him, and that following God may seem difficult to us, but if we'll be obedient, we're going to be blessed by the word of God. And so it's inspired by God, all scripture. And we understood that it said all, that there's every bit of it from Genesis 1:1, Revelation 22:21. All scripture has been given to us by God. There's nothing in it that we look at this word that God has not given. He didn't say you're going to like it, but he says is good for you. For a wise man begins to get the counsel of God, and when he's a wise man, he begins to say, yes, amen, and give me more. How many of you tonight in here are wise? Huh?
Right.
Wise men say, Lord, this wisdom is good.
Good.
Give me more. Good. How many of you tonight are wise?
Bring it on.
Amen. Lord, what you give to me is good. Give me more. I understand, Lord, what you're doing for me is good. Because it's going to make me a better individual. I will be a brighter light in the midst of this darkness. Lord, I will stand when other people think I should have crumbled. The goodness of God. The goodness of God. How do you praise God in the midst of adversity? Because I've grown in the wisdom of God that he is God no matter where I find myself going through. He's worthy of praise. Ain't that right, Rita? Amen. That's right. Amen. So it talks about that not only is the inspiration, but he is the author of the Bible. That he is the one that is given it, and that man is the instrument that the Holy Spirit used to write the Bible. And so when people tell us all the time that is just some man's ideal of things, and so-and-so wrote another good book, and so-and-so, they tell you all of these things here. Usually when so-and-so really has something that has some truth to it, you'll find out he just, what's the word? Plagiarized. He stole it from God because he couldn't came up with it. He tried to change it, but all he did was give us the Message Bible instead of just calling it the NIV. He tried to make it sound like it was something he created. That thought, look what I came up with, but we can find that it is Scripture. Because anything that is good has to come from God. Man cannot do this. And that's what it's telling us, is that we can trust this word of God and that he used men to do it. And because of it, the difficultness of the Bible tells us that it has to be born again to be able to comprehend the things of the word of God. And we talked about how that people who don't know the Lord are trying to tell Christians that this is not the word of God. And they will tell you, well, I read it, and it's just another book. And that's what it will be for those who are not born again. But for those who are saved, those who have received the good news of Jesus Christ, they know it is life to us. It is the bread, it is the water that allows us to sustain us, to be able to face today. We have cried out many a time, thank you, Lord. If it had not been for you, where would I be? It was the Word of God, the Holy Spirit ministering to you. And you knew that no matter where I've been in this situation, it was God who was my strength all along the way. I know it was him. I know it was him. He's the one that opened up the door. But then I want to tell you about the other part of this Word of God. Because I also know those that will say to us, God told me. And I said, okay, if God told you, does it line up with God's Word? They quote me one scripture. I asked them about the other 10, the other 20, the other 30, the other 40 scriptures that says what they're telling me goes against what God says. But I know it's God. I said, then how well did it work for you? Well, it hasn't worked yet, but it's just because that's me. And I said, you got one thing right. It's me. And anytime me is involved in the equation of God, I'm always going to come up with a fat zero. Nothing will begin to manifest. Nothing will come forward. And it's important that we understand that because I'm not going to argue with the foolish. I'm not going to spend time and hours with those that really don't want nothing. Because all they have to do is continue to talk to you and you will understand there's nothing godly going on in them. But pastor, they've been going to church with me for 20 years, and I will still say to you, how well are they doing? How well are they doing? Well, you know, they got some stuff going on in their life. And then I'll say to them, and I'll say to you, how many of you here tonight have some stuff going on in your life? Do you have some stuff going on? Yeah, we do. So if you got some stuff going on in your life, you're not exempt then. Everybody's got some stuff. Your stuff may seem like a lot more because it's your stuff. But if I got stuff going on, it's pretty important to me too. Everybody's got stuff. But there ought to be some fruit when Christ is operating in your life and the Word of God is being applied to your life. And it says you will know them by their... So if you keep telling me you're an apple tree and I have not seen one apple you produced in 20 years, I'm telling you you're a tree that needs to be cut down. And you say, now you're judging me. I'm just judging your fruit. And if you don't have any, there doesn't take much to judge. You say, why would you say that? The Word of God. The Word of God says we need to check to make sure that our election is true, that it is right. And if we are right with God and striving after the things of God, you will begin to see the fruit of God operating in your life. In your life. I didn't say that you're going to be rich and have a fancy house and all the things there and stuff. I'm not saying that you're going to marry the tallest man, the richest man in the world. You might just be married to Ray. He ain't here. When you ain't here, you're open, buddy. I'm telling you. You don't get to cover yourself.
Nobody will tell him.
Yeah. Eli, Richard, you're going to tell him first thing Sunday. I know you will. But I say to Nathan, praise God, you my. May not work with anybody else. She works well with me. Works well with me. Wayne would tell you different. That Betty is the lucky one to have Wayne. But everybody that knows Wayne knows he's the lucky one.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And then I just go to show you that you can be here and you're still not saved. You're not saved. So it says that it's a difficult book. It's difficult because it came from an infinite to the finite, from the unlimited, all-powerful God to limited man. And that's the part where we struggle at with the Word of God. We have to understand that we're not God. And even as we grow, and you've experienced it, that I went back and I've read it over and I've read it over and I've read it over, and every time I read it over again, I get something else out of it. That's the good thing about the Word of God. You will never be able to sit down and say, okay, I got it. Because when you look at that book again next year, you're going to say, I didn't see that last year. I've been looking at this and I never saw that before. Because this Word is alive. And it brings forth life for those who seek it out. And so we looked at that. It talked about the oneness of the book of God. And that it is... It talks about the goodness of God from beginning to end. The oneness or the unity of the Bible, and that it is a mystery. It talked about the 66 books, 35 different authors, 150 years that it took the span to write. It talks about all the things of history, law, science, poetry, drama, biography, prophecy. And yet with its various parts are as harmoniously united as the parts that make up the human body. And that everything is there for a reason. And when it's done, it's complete. And that's what the Word of God is. It's complete. From front to back. I can trust it, Frank. I can trust it. We can trust it. And that's what God is trying to tell us. And that's why we're studying this Word. Because you're going to be challenged in life, as we talked about before, with things that are so hard. And God's Word is just saying, trust me. Trust me. Your bank account isn't giving you the right answer you want. Your job is not producing what you wanted to do. The family may be a big struggle for you. There may be a lot of things. The doctor's report was not what you wanted to hear. And yet when you get into the Word of God and begin to get into the presence of God, He will say to us, no matter what, trust me. So I have to believe that this Word is God's Word from front to back, everything inside and out, and that it is complete for your life and for my life. That I can trust Him. That I can trust Him. That I can trust Him. Because sometimes in a Christian's life, that's all you got is Jesus and God's Word. That's all you got. It's the only hope that you got coming your way. Because you might find yourself in the back of a church laying up on a bench with your TV plugged in, with your VCR, watching a 35-year-old movie. And that's the only hope you seem to have. But with Christ, We don't have to see that as an end. We can see it as a place where I've been. But God is one who says to us, take up your mat and walk. Take up your mat and walk. I'm saying I can share hope with everybody and anybody because of God's word. Because it doesn't depend on you and doesn't depend on me. It's all about him. So he that plants is nothing, he that waters is nothing, but it's him who brings the increase. I do not have a problem putting the ball in God's court. And that's what the word of God tells us to do. Put it in God's court. Test him, try him, and see if he will not be God for our life. How do I know that? That's what the word says. That's what the word says. So then this word is telling us that this infinite God has allowed us to come and understand the oneness of the Bible. Understand that God has a plan for us and has used many different people from different walks. And then he says that for the church, that we are a body made up of different people. And the only thing we have in common is Jesus. And I've said it to us as a congregation before, the person on your left or right, sitting in front of you, behind you, you would have nothing to do with them if it had not been for the Lord. Would never run with them. They wouldn't have you at their house, and you wouldn't have them at yours. We ran in different circles, have different thoughts, ideas, come from one side of the track to another. And then Christ brings us together, and we have this common bond that seals us into eternity. God, the church. The church, I'm telling you, is such a thing, and that's what the word of God tells us. The infinite God is able to do this and give us instruction. It tells us about this oneness, and I want to read this note to you. The Bible is a difficult book because it came from the infinite to the finite, from the unlimited, all-powerful God to a limited man. But in verse 6 down here at the bottom in John 3, 6, it says, flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit, and filled with the Spirit. Ephesians 5:18, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit of God. I think it's still important that we need to know that no matter how much word you think you got, if the Spirit of God is not operating, influencing your life, you are still on empty. Or I'll put it this way, you're a car full of gas with no key. Got the ability to go miles upon miles, go as fast as you could go, but you don't have the key. You don't have nothing to turn you on to get you where you need to be. The importance of the Holy Spirit. And we need to know that you need the Spirit of God to operate in us. So we know that God has called us into existence. He sent his son to die, and now he's empowered us with himself that we might live a productive life in him. And so we need God, and you have Christ in you. Yes, sir.
Why does God's word give us that analogy between be not drunk on wine and being filled with the Spirit? What is that a good analogy? Why is God, what's God trying to get across to us there?
At Pentecost, some people thought they were drunk when they were being filled with the Holy Spirit.
They did. Do you have any idea?
Yeah.
Well, let's hear it. I'll let you know if you're right.
Have you ever been drunk?
Have I ever been drunk?
Yeah.
Has the sun ever came up?
when I used to drink a few beers, it would take about 5 beers, and I could whip anybody in the place, you know? Because I had a liberty that I did not have before.
Okay.
I was set at liberty. The book says that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
That's right.
If the church ever needed liberty today, we need to be filled with the Spirit so that we can have the liberty that God wants us to have to do what he wants us to do.
So then that liberty allows us to move in the supernatural empowerment of God.
Without fear.
Without fear. Supernatural empowerment of God to go forward into places that I would not tread on my own, would not do. And that makes sense to me. It makes sense to me because what I do in Christ Jesus and for the kingdom of God, I wouldn't do for myself. I wouldn't do it. I've said it in a way that I can understand it. You can say a lot of things about me. You can say things and do things and might even be able to do that concerning my mom. But when it comes to the things of the Lord, I can't be quiet. I can't let you say something that contradicts what God's word has said or what the Holy Spirit is able to do. I can't be still. A lot of things I could just keep my mouth shut because it really doesn't matter one way or another. It doesn't change anything. But when it comes to the things of God, then that's a different story. I'm willing to deal with the conflict or deal with the idea that we may not be on the same page and you may not even like what I'm going to say, but it don't matter. It don't matter. Yes. I'm going to talk to you because I think you get it. It don't matter because I'm going to glorify God. And I know what He's done in my life and I cannot be still when it comes to Him. I can't let you just say anything about my God and what He is able to do. When you tell me God ain't in that, I can tell you He is in that and why He's in that. And it may not make sense to anybody else, but I know what the Word says and I know what He did in me. Oh, no, I was blind, but now I see. I was lame, but now I'm able to walk. I know my life has changed. Don't tell me that God don't save. He can save. He will save. All you have to do is just believe and receive, and you will know that what I'm telling you is true. I think you're right. I think it's a liberty with the Spirit of God.
How do you do?
All right. Amen. So, the liberty that you may have found in this little bug juice that you were drinking. A little freer, feeling a little bolder. It says now that we need to allow the Holy Spirit to operate in that. It will cause a man who lied to stop lying and tell the truth even when it cost him. It will cause the thief to ask for something where pride would have had him steal it and see if he could get away with it. Spirit of God. Liberty. Yes, sir.
If I'm more than a conqueror, I can whip anybody now. Now, we're talking about a spiritual kingdom today that we work and we live and we move in a spiritual world today. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of forces that work in planet Earth and in America and in Canton, Illinois. And we need to have that attitude, I can whip anyone in the house. And it only comes through being filled with the Spirit.
Okay, then not necessarily, I'm going to change that. Because some of us may feel uncomfortable about whipping. But overcoming every circumstance situation that comes our way. And that I can rise above it. I can look past it because I'm looking towards Him. I can rise above that. I can do all things through Christ, who is my strength. My flesh may not allow me to do that. Someone may come out and call you out of your name that would have caused you in a time to try to whip everybody in the house. But now in Christ, that we hear what they're saying, and then begin to show them something different about what Jesus is able to do. Give the brothers our love.
I will.
All right, God bless you. And so, maybe not whip, but understand that you're empowered to overcome every circumstance situation. Now you say, now wait a minute, if I'm sick unto death, how do I overcome that situation? Paul said it's better to be with the Lord. That we come to knowing that this is not our home. We are pilgrims. We are passing through. Somewhere, someplace, even Methuselah, the oldest man who had ever lived, died.
Yep.
It's going to happen. If you live long enough, you'll live long enough to die. If the Lord should tarry. But I can be a conqueror no matter what that I find myself in. I shared today that Ivan, in those last days of his life, when people were coming in and visiting, the nurses were changing shifts, the CNAs were changing their shifts, he was asking them, were they right with the Lord? Did they have the comfort or peace? Were they putting their trust in him? That if they didn't know that God was God, that they really needed to know that he is real, that he is alive, and that he's a life changer. He would ask them, do you know that if something should happen to you, would you go to heaven? Would you go to heaven? There was something about this understanding that he had made a choice that I know my day is coming to an end. But I'm all right with it because I have a promise. And so he was asking them the question, if your day would come to an end, are you all right? Will you be all right? Would you be okay? If suddenly you knew you were going to die, would you find yourself in the presence of God? And he said to them, you can know that. You can know that. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. There was times when I shared with Ivan that I don't think that he was sure. And so we went through it. Barbara went through it, didn't you? Had to do it over and over again. But when he got it, he understood, I'm all right. It don't matter. It has nothing to do with me. It does everything according to what he has done, the finished work of Jesus. And so he was sharing. He was sharing. He said, I got it. And you can have it too. I think then that he whipped that old flesh that hindered him, that kept him down. But all of a sudden he was free and empowered by the Holy Spirit. And so he could do all things through Christ, that even in the face of death, he was free. He was free to worship and to praise the Lord with everything that was in him. So we have this in the Word of God, and that is powerful. But I want to look at this where it says, for the Word of God is living and is powerful. The Bible claims that his dividing power as a sword, the above verse, and it read in Hebrews 4:12, for the Word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of our soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and is discerner of the thoughts and the intent of the heart. What is that saying to us? You've heard this scripture before. For the Word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and of marrow, and is discerning of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. If you're not sure, then you didn't read your homework. But what does it say to us?
With power and alert word, it cannot be fooled. It knows what's right, what's wrong. It knows how to separate. Those are not truly believing, those are.
The Word of God cuts right through the chase. It allows you to know that God is able to save. It will cause one heart to melt before the presence of God, and it will cause others to harden like clay in under the sun. The butter melts, the clay gets hard, same sun. That's how you were designed, what you're willing to be part of, what you're willing to do. It's able to get me out of the way so my spirit man can have the truth of God. It's able to cut me, get money out of the way. Have you ever needed to get out of the way so the Spirit of God can operate in you? That's what it does. That word is able to cut. That a man can come to the saving knowledge of Christ, but the Christian can make the right choices in the things of God and be able to move with him and live with him in the power of God. So the Word of God is living and is powerful, is sharper than any two-edged sword. It cuts going in, cuts coming out. it allows us to be free. Many of you have had surgery, had something bad in, something wrong on the inside. They went in, they took away the pain. You were in pain, you were in discomfort, they cut away. And then after they got done with the surgery, you said, I think I hurt worse now than I did before I had the surgery. But after a few weeks that went by, the healing process began to happen within you. And that that used to hurt you doesn't hurt you anymore. And what caused the pain you were last feeling has now set you free. The Holy Spirit, the Word of God, comes and it cuts. It cuts away that that is of the flesh, and it brings forth the things of life for us. So it's a two-edged sword. It is a sword that cuts, but it also sets us free. It separates man from man that he might understand the things of God, have relationship with God, and yet walk in a wholeness that comes, piercing even the division of the soul of man, my thoughts, my idea, to the spirit man. Because the Word of God says again, and I can't get off of it, that my ways are not his ways, my thoughts are not his thoughts. And his ways are higher than my ways, and his thoughts are higher than my thoughts. That when I understand that, that my nature begins to change to be like his nature. Your nature begins to change like his nature. So it's no longer I that lives, but it is Christ that lives within me. And so the Word of God does that for us. The Spirit of God that is in us begins to operate. And how close is it as the same as the joints and the marrow, the bone marrow, that is in that bone, the closeness, how close is it? It is that joint and the marrow, that the life source for us to be able to move in the things of God, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. It's so clear that when the Spirit of God begins to operate, the Word of God begins to deal with us, it even begins to minister to even the thoughts and the intent of my heart. So that when we look at scriptures in Psalms 119, 11, I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you, or sin will separate man from, separate man's form, the Bible. In Isaiah 59, 2, but your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. So here it tells us that this word is such that it causes a man to say, I want to be right with you. I want to be better. I want to live a life for you. Why? Because the Word of God begins to minister to us in such a way that causes me to want to reach out for something that I had not thought about reaching out before. Because I was happy being saved, and now I come to a place where being saved just ain't enough. I want more. The Word of God tells me I can have more. The Word of God tells me I can grow in this relationship with the Lord. And so I begin to want more. We begin to want more. Why are you here tonight? Such a beautiful evening, and you have chose to come and be here for the Word of God. Because this Word of God begins to transform our lives in such a way, and it has impacted us, that we begin to say, Lord, I want to understand, walk with you in a better way, closer way. And the only way I'm able to do that is to begin to allow your word to have its way within me and through me. The word, it helps me move past my thoughts, my ideas. It helps me to get past me. The word of God helps me to get past me. Can you say that with me? The word of God helps me to get past me. Did I say that by myself?
Yeah.
I need you to say that with me. The Word of God helps me to get past me. Because who's been the biggest struggle in your life?
Me.
Me. Not me, but you're me. Yeah. Yeah. The biggest struggle has been me. The person I look at in the mirror. In fact, James tells me when I look at the Word of God, that it says that I see what that word is reflecting to me, or what I need to be. It says, but then I'm like a man who forgets what I look like in the mirror, and all of a sudden I'm back doing the same things that I've done. But the Word of God began to reveal to me, and that's what that's saying. It's saying that Word of God begins to show us who we are, that we begin to even cry out, create in me a clean heart. I've hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you, knowing that sin separates us from God. And so, and when we're not in a right place with Him, I will find out that I'm not where I need to be. I'm not spending time in the Word. I'm not spending time in His presence. I'm not applying the principles of God to my life. I'm not doing the things that stir up the life of Christ that is in me. And when I'm not in His presence doing what He's called me to do, me has a tendency to show up. So if you're dealing with me, I'm asking you, are you doing the things that you need to do to cause you to live strong and live right in Christ Jesus? When you have done your best living in Christ, what were you doing to obtain that relationship with God? And when you stop doing that, you will find that you slide down. There is no such thing as I'm in neutral in my relationship with God. I'm either going up or I'm sliding down. I'm either about the things of God or I'm not about the things of God. I thought that I could chill, but there is no such thing as that. You're either going to be about the things of God or you're going to be about nothing. And so the Word of God is that, through the Spirit of God, is able to make it alive in us, that we have that. The Bible, we see ourselves as God sees us. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. I do not like the idea of the thought that I'm not perfect. And then the Bible said to me that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And in the midst of hearing that, I began to tell you about all the good things that I acquire and I'm able to do. I began to tell you how I'm not as bad. Now, I may have to pick out Jeff's to say, compare it to Jeff's. Yeah. I'm not near as bad. I'm not near as bad. But when we compare ourselves to the Holy One, the Son of Man, Jesus the Christ, we all come up short. When He becomes our measuring stick, we begin to understand how much in need am I of a Savior. How much we need of a Savior. And sometimes in our argument with those who are lost, or those Christians who are struggling in their relationship with the Lord, we need to say to them, have you compared yourself to Him who is able? And if you are, how well are you doing? Now, I'm not talking about the perfection of Christ, because who could measure up? But if my life is not bringing Him glory and honor, then I'm not in the place where I need to be, because if Christ is in me, should I not be doing better? Should you not be doing better? Does it get hard or draining to try to live a better life in Christ Jesus?
Say that again.
Does it become hard or draining to try to live a better life in Christ Jesus?
Sometimes.
Now, I was thinking about, Barb says no, but I'm just going to tell you, the person who is exercising their faith will say that. Even in that, I have difficulties, because why? As I grow in the things of the Lord, the weights seem to be heavier, because He's saying, all right, you're here now, I want you to come up there. And it seems like that's a little strange, because why? I was feeling pretty good about this here, Lord. I thought we'd just hang around here for a year or two. And He's saying, but no, time is running short. I need you to come up here and be here with me. And when you get there, you say, okay, Lord, this is good. And He says, yeah, that's really good. But you know, this is even better. And then in the midst of that growth, you're finding yourself dealing with the trials, tribulations of life that continue to come your way. Nothing begins to slow down. Things may even begin to accelerate and come at you at even a greater speed. And He's calling you to come to hear. And you're saying, Lord, I want to live for You, but man, You don't know what I'm dealing with right now. You don't know about this thing that's coming my way. And He's still calling us to this here. And sometimes when you're trying to live here, you're trying to bring other people along the way, and you're saying, Lord, nobody wants to come. Sometimes you may feel like the prophet, Lord, nobody's hearing Your word. I'm the only one following after You. Because those that you're pouring out to don't seem to be getting it. Do not seem to be receiving it. There doesn't seem to be any. You seem like you're just pouring water that would bring forth life out on the cement because there's no growth, no nothing coming forth out of it. And sometimes it appears that it is being hard, but here this word tells us that this word of God, it is powerful. This word of God is reminds me of that the sinner is the flesh is a difficult thing, and yet I recognize that, and I know that God is greater. And what it does then is energizes us to know that I too was once like they were. I got that out of the Bible too. Because, see, none of you got to here without starting down here. Lost, in need of a Savior. Being a Christian and not living your Christianese life. Knowing to do good and finding yourself not doing it. Knowing the things that you hate and yet being drawn to them and continuously to do them. Sometimes even beating your own self up instead of remembering that the Word of God says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. And that God doesn't make junk. And these are the things that how important the Word of God is, because sometimes you just need to be healed through the Word of God, be comforted in the Word of God, be encouraged in the Word of God. But this sinful nature that it reminds us that this Word is able to reflect upon us the need of God to come to salvation, but it should also continue to reflect upon us the need of God to grow in our walk with the Lord. So all of sin comes short of the glory of God, and then it goes on to tell us, but the Word of God is a cleansing, it's a powerful Word. As to make her holy, the talking about, it says, Christ's love for the church, and he gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain, wrinkle, or other blemishes, but holy and blameless. That the word of God allows that to come into our lives because of who Christ is and what he desires for us to have. And now, that's what the word does. It is able to present us, the Spirit of God that is in us. It reminds us that I can't get me to that place, but the Spirit of God gets me to that. And when I begin to understand that, Frank, I begin to understand it's a work of God. It's a work of God that you and I ain't where we used to be. A work of God. It's a work of God that you're not where you used to be. A work of God. The Holy Spirit operating in you. You trusting in God's word, allowing God's spirit in you to transform you. And so, again, all of this is about for us to get down within our spirit, man, how important the word of God is for us. And that it is able to get us to a place that we could not get ourselves to. The Bible claims special powers. It talks about all of those things. It talks about that it is sharp, it is living, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. I'm looking at number 4. The Bible says in notes that for the word of God is living and powerful. The Bible claims dividing all of those things. It's reflecting. The Bible says it's reflecting. But go back up to Isaiah 59:2 again. That but your iniquities have separated you from God, and your sins have been hidden from his face. I just need to know tonight that as we're looking at that word of God, that I got to know who I am. I've said to you before, and I'll say to you again, would you like to know the person that God says you are? If I've known you before the foundations of the world, I knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb, would you like to know that person that God knows? And the Word of God says that person can begin to be revealed to us as we continue to walk out and live out the Word of God for our lives, trusting in him along the way. And that's what he's calling us to. He's calling us to a place of trusting him no matter where we find ourselves, trusting him and watching him form us. So who's better than they used to be?
We are.
Better than I used to be. I ain't there yet, but I'm better than I used to be. Are you disagreeing with
her? Praise God.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. But even that isn't where he wants us to stop. He wants us to say, but that's still not the person I see. Do you want to know that person? There was a time, Lord, that when I hit my thumb with the hammer, I would have, but I don't talk like that anymore. How come you know what I'm talking about, Miss? Huh? Mrs. Kid, you know what I'm talking about, don't you? Okay, all right. We're just keeping it real tonight. Yeah. But because of Christ in us, we might now go, oh, Lord Jesus, help me. Help me. Oh, because why? It still hurts. You hit your finger with the thumb, hit your thumb with the hammer, it's still going to hurt, even if you're a strong Christian. But my flesh doesn't have to dictate to me because the Word of God tells me I'm a new creation. I have been created in Christ Jesus. The old has passed away, and I have become new in Him. I talked to you about James and his Word, that when I look into the mirror, immediately forgetting. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that it gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. And sometimes when I look at James, I forget that last part. I remember the fact that I looked at the Word, I saw myself, and I forgot. But it promises me that when I look into it intently, when I'm looking at it to get something out of it that's going to transform the circumstance situation I find myself living in, dealing with, it says, I will grow in the things of the Lord, and I will grow in Him in such a way, and I will be transformed in Him by the glory of God. Not forgetting, but doing it, and they will be blessed in what they do. Going back with Wayne has said earlier, I can do all things through Christ now, who is my strength. Those things in life that I need to accomplish, I can accomplish in the things of the Lord. The Bible claims cleansing power down at the bottom of number 3. The Bible claims cleansing power as water. Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her body, washing her with the water through the word, to present her to himself. And I read that to you. It says, but as the radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. Holy and blameless. Holy and blameless. I understand that the church is a collaboration of each and every one of us coming. We're all many members to it, but we make up the church. But my part in the church is important. Your part in the church is important. Now I understand that I may be able to build up my arms, I may be able to lift up a heavy weight, and my tongue has no say-so in how much weight I can lift up. But it's still being victorious as I grow in the things of the Lord. But the Bible also tells me about my tongue. My tongue is that can cause me to get in trouble. My tongue has said things that my jaw paid for, my nose paid for, my eye paid for. My eye never said one thing and took the trouble from the tongue. It said it's a member. And so the Word of God tells us about these different parts. But it's important that every one of these parts be used to the glory of God. So when the church becomes that radiant part of God, it reflects, it's the body of Christ, it's the bride of Christ, what you do has some effect on the radiance of the church. So the church is not just built up of pillars, it's built up of every part of the church. Have a beautiful emphasis at where everybody can come in and praise the Lord. We have no seats. You just have to come in and stand for the next 2.5 hours listen to him just go on. And you say, boy, this was really good and stuff, but I really would like it if it was a place to sit down. I'm just saying is that it takes everything to make it work. It takes everything. Beautiful car, all the tires on it, everything else. I mean, the radio comes on, everything, no engine. No engine.
Yeah. I owned that car once.
I still drive that. I do good going down. It's that going up is hard, you know.
Well, I got drunk, but didn't have no engine.
I'm just saying is that you are important to this radiant church. Because sometimes when we talk about the church and the glory of God, we're looking at it, but I'm looking at it at you and not thinking about my part in this. And this church that God is bringing to the fullness, it includes you. And so, for this body to operate right, it needs you. It needs me to become everything God would have me to be. And so now, this is the other exercise. Turn to somebody and say, I need you.
I need you.
I need you. I need you. I need you. Oh, okay, all right. I need you. And that's so important in the body of Christ. Because it's not about us. We need each other. But I need you running at your best. I need you running at your best. If we're in the boat and we all got oars, all the oars have to go in the water at the same time, stroke at the same time. You can't just go any way you want to go when someone is saying stroke and you're just having a good time. Or all the left oars go into the water and all the right oars stay up. And we say we never seem to get anywhere, but we've been going in a circle for quite some time. The importance of needing each other, working with each other, striving after the same things of the Lord. And that's what God is calling us to. He's calling us to that place of relationship so that we will become that radiant church, that church that is without blemish, coming to being strong. I hear all the time people coming into the church, and you know what they're saying to me in their first visit? When I talk to them, I was going to give you a percentage, but I really don't know what it would be. But I have not had anyone ever come into this church and say, since I've been here, that this church ain't friendly. Felt that they were received. That so much so that I'm coming back. I'm coming back. Everybody was cordial and stuff and sincere about it. And I just felt like this is it. The importance of the body. And it doesn't mean then that we're always going to get along, that we're always going to be functioning right. Because we've had toothaches, we've had feet hurting, back hurting, arms hurting, neck hurting. We've had some parts of the body not function right. And it affects the whole body. But then we strive then to bring wholeness to that part as we do our physical bodies. The Word of God spends a lot of time talking about the importance of the body of Christ coming into that full relationship that God has called us to. Man is natural and therefore limited and does not always speak the truth. And there's some things about man. I won't say every man, but I'm just going to say this man. Sometimes I struggle. I got ahead of myself. Go up to David on the next page. David prayed that God would wash him from iniquities and cleanse him from sin. Have mercy on me. Oh God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquities and cleanse me from my sins. Cleanse me. Cleanse me from my sins. That should be a desire of our hearts. I should never want to be satisfied being here. I'm better than I used to be. But I really know what this is still. It's not where God would have me to be. Yes, Lord. You got a hotline, John.
When Jill Hall, I don't know.
My mom. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquities and cleanse me from my sins. So it talks about that. I recognize that I'm a sinner, but it's powerful and it's cleansing. It's cleansing. I need to let you know that the Word of God is cleansing. 5 years after you're a Christian, 10 years after you're a Christian, 20 years after you're a Christian, somebody told me, I've been going to First Baptist Church, I heard you that, for 69 years. And if he hadn't been so tall, I would have told him, you still got a lot of work to do. And he's still growing. Still growing. Still understanding I'm not there. There's still things that I need to work on in my life. There's still things. I've been here for 69 years. I'm still growing. That we understand that I may come short, but the blood of Jesus still blots out my sin. I'm still covered in that. Bless you. Oh no, that's right. You just needed a blessing. The blood of Jesus still blots out my sins. I'm coming up short. But I still desire to live a righteous, holy life. And that's what the Word of God causes us to do. The Spirit of God continues to do. So it reminds us that we're sinning. That we're sinner needing salvation. But it also reminds us that God is still calling us to that place. And even though I sin, I do not drop from the bottom of the ladder to the bottom rung. And that God says, okay, you realize that this ain't me. That's right, Lord. Forgive me. And he says, then come on, let's go. Let's go. Let's get about it. I would like to spend all that time talking to God about why I came and why I did what I did, why I said what I did. You know, God ain't interested in any of that. What he's interested in is that when you are convicted by the Holy Spirit, according to the Word of God, that you have come short of the glory of God, that you're quick to respond by asking for forgiveness and understanding that he has saved you. And understand if you know what caused you to do that, stop it. Stop it. Stop it. If I know this is what's keeping me from going to hell, the Holy Spirit's really telling me, stop it. And then I may have to do some things that will cause me to stop. We didn't read it here, but it tells me I need to pluck out an eye. I need to cut off the hand. I need to do something that is drastic because why I want this more than I want this. Even though this is better than I used to be. But to get here, sometimes I have to drastically and do something so out of character. Because I know that I've tried to do with my own understanding and strength to stop it. And now I have to become radical in the sense that I want this so bad. That if it means I got to take the TV and throw it out of the house, you throw it out of the house. If you got to cut off some friends because you know running with them is running nowhere, you cut off your friends. And some of those may be even family members for a time period. Because I got some family members you can't run with. You can't run with. They're in a cesspool. You can't run with them. And you might want to share Christ with them, but to share Christ with them, you're going to be in the cesspool this deep. And they have to realize that they're in the cesspool before you'll be able to share something with them. All you'll do is just get all stinked up with them, and nothing's going to change in their life. And so I have to climb out of that cesspool and understand they're not ready to hear the truth because they have not allowed the Word of God to remind them, the Spirit of God, that is sharper than any two-edged sword, that they are a sinner in need of a Savior. Because where they're at, they think that they are in a good place and they're okay. Now I say all of that. It's because for us as a church to come into a fullness of what God is calling us to, that I have to understand for me to get there, I may have to do some drastic things to get there. And some of those things there are to let people know, can't run with you anymore. Can't hang out with you anymore. I have to call and tell them, I don't need the premium channel anymore. Because the stuff on it that trips me up, I don't need this. I don't need this anymore because why? I understand it hinders me from coming and where God has to be. I may have to say to this flesh, you got to get up. Because I need to have time in the Word because I find that when I'm in the Word in the morning, when I'm in the presence of God, my day goes better. So I may have to learn how to beat this flesh into submission. Because flesh don't like to obey the things of God. It continues to fight with it. How do I know that the Word of God tells me that? And I'm saying for us to be victorious in Christ, and we're going to stop there tonight, that I may have to begin to become desperate in the sense that I want it so bad, this is what it's going to take. That things that may have had a hold on me in such a way, I may have to gnaw my hand off to get free. But the question is, do you want this? Is this where you want to live in your relationship with God? Do you want to know that person that He has called you to? And if your answer is yes, I want to encourage you. You got to do some gnawing? Do some gnawing. Whip that flesh into submission because why? I need you. Because why? We're the body. We're the body of Christ. We are the temple of the living God. We are the church. And every part of the body has to be striving for this. Oh, some of us may never preach in a big arena, may not do this, may not do that, but we got areas of influence in our life that God has called us to touch those areas. And I have to be striving for this so He can use me in that place to impact, to make a life-changing difference for somebody else. But to do that, I'm going to have to make some choices. You're going to have to make some choices. And so the Bible is the Word of God. It is truth for us. It allows us to begin to grow in a relationship with the Lord. It is life to us. It is food for us. It is that cleanses us. It reminds us where we're at and it tells us where we can go. In a good way. It is the Word of God. And it is anointed. It's powerful. It will cut me in the places that I didn't want to be cut in. But if I allow it to happen, it will bring forth healing to me and I will be so much better for it. Walking this Christian walk, you may have some pain along the way, striving after the things of the Lord. I said to you that being there in New York, that I realized there in Brooklyn, what the Jewish people were saying, we have left all to follow Christ. Amen. That they had cut deep. But they knew that Christ was able to heal them. Because they said, I believe the Word of God and that Jesus is Yeshua. Okay. Separated from their family, Peter said, we have left all. And Jesus says, father, mother, brothers, sisters, houses, land, for my sake, I'll give back to you. I will heal you and I will give back to you more than you've ever had before. But to do that, I will begin to make choices And some of those choices are going to be hard and become difficult. And the Word of God deals with all of those things for your life and for my life. And I thought it was so important that we touch on that tonight, because the Word of God is not a word that just is that it always has something just good to say, and it just really makes you feel good when you get done reading it. No, the Word of God is real, and it deals with us with life issues, life situations. But all of those situations, when we are obedient to the Word of God, will take us to this place in Christ Jesus. And that word will separate the soul from the spirit. Amen. Now, you can look at the rest of the this on the Bible dealing with that. That we study to show ourselves approved, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly able to divide the word of truth. This word is God's word. It is the word of God. And that's what we need to know, that we can take that word, we can apply that word to our life in every area. Natural man cannot get it. We must be born again. It gives those illustrations. It talks about who do we owe. Are we going to run after the things of the world, or are we going to run after the things of the Lord? So render unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and what belongs to God, give it to God. If you're a child of God and you've been born again, you belong to Him. And you no longer give to Caesar. You know, we live in this world, but we're not of this world. And that's hard. I believe that the Bible is telling us, I'm calling you to this place and it seems impossible to get there. And I'm telling you it's an attainable goal. What does that look like? It looks like the first person who said, boy, Mount Everest is really tall, but I think I'm going to climb it. Oh, you'll never be able to climb that mountain. Many people have tried to climb that mountain. They have fallen. They are dead. They're laying up in that mountain. Nobody has ever climbed that mountain. But you know, once one person began to climb the mountain and got to the top, and who was it?
Hillary.
Was he the only person?
Not a mainstream.
Huh?
Lots more done since.
A lot more after that. It's an attainable goal. It's an attainable goal. This is an attainable goal for the child of God. And Jesus said, how do you know it is? He says, because I've been to the Father and I'll show you how to get. I know how to do this. I've lived here in this life that you're living in. And I can tell you, when you're obedient to the Word of God, your eyes are fixed on Him, you're applying it to Him, you can have this in Him. So let's climb the mountain. Let's dare to climb where nobody else you know has ever climbed before. Let's attain them. And let's do this together. Amen. I want to hear him say, when you put it there on the top of that mountain, well done, my good and faithful servant. Well done. You believe and you receive. It's attainable. It's attainable. Any questions of what we've looked at tonight? Everybody's good. Everybody's good. Did everybody get a chance to sign on the prayer sheet? Barb and John will be traveling, leaving Friday.
Tomorrow
afternoon. Ride safe. Ride safe. Get your train legs going. Enjoy that grandbaby.
I can't wait.
I know you can't. You know. But don't get in a hurry. Stay on the train. Okay. All right. All right. Our prayers go with you. We're so thankful. Yes.
If I may, Pat, I think
like to have a mention in prayer for Todd. He had a mass taken out today. They've sent it off in case they're concerned about a mass that they took out today.
Did they take it out?
Yeah, they had the hemorrhoids. There were two hemorrhoids.
Hernias, yeah.
The doctor said he had one patch. There was two of them, two hernias, and the patch covered those sufficiently. But he's worried. He mentioned two or three times about this mass. He called it a mass. And I think they looked at it at Graham, but that was a quick look at it. Then they're going to send it off and see, you know, whether it's malignant or whatever.
Okay. Right. But they did remove it?
Yes.
Okay, so it wasn't a biopsy of it. They took it out. Okay,
all right. They took the whole mass out.
They took the whole mass out.
Yeah, they took it out.
Okay, all right. I wasn't sure if it was a biopsy or what they did. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, and definitely keep him and keep Wendy in prayer also. Any others?
My sister-in-law.
In the hospital or home recuperating?
She's home.
Recuperating?
Yes.
What's her name?
Belinda Burnham.
Did you put her on the prayer list?
Yes.
Okay, well, let's make sure. So we'll have those and we'll continue to pray for her. Okay.
What's her name? Belinda Burnham.
Any others? Yes, sir.
That we have a smooth transition once Ashley comes home tomorrow. So we've gone 3 years, 4 months ago. So that we have a smooth transition and she's home for good this time.
Okay, all right, we'll do that. Did you put that on the prayer list?
That's what they're probably on.
She covered her family only.
Okay, all right, sometimes we have to be specific so we know what we're, I know God knows, but sometimes we just need to know what we're praying about. Okay. All right, any others? Well, let's pray. Father, we come tonight, Lord, and we do lift up those on our prayer concern list. We know, dear Heavenly Father, that your word tells us to come boldly before your throne. Your word tells us if there's any sick among you, Lord, to lay hands upon them, anoint them with oil. But it tells us, Lord, there's power in prayer, and that we should pray without ceasing, pray believing that it shall be done. And so, Lord, we thank you today, Lord, that you are Todd and Wendy's healer. You are able to touch, Lord, that area that where this mass has been formed. And though the doctor says that it doesn't look good, it is suspect to be this, Lord, we know that you're greater than this. And so we bring him before you, Lord. We know you are doing a great work in Todd, and we're asking you, Lord, to just continue and bring forth your healing virtue, Lord, to his physical body now and to his wives. We pray for Rita's sister-in-law, and we lift her up to you as she fell. We don't know the condition, Lord, but you know, and we ask that you would just comfort her, Lord, at this time and be with her. And Lord, we also pray for Ashley when she's coming home, and that the transition, Lord, will be smooth. Lord, we know that she loves you. We know that she is in you. And we ask that you would guard her heart and her mind, that you would find peace, Lord, in you and in her family. And so, Lord, we come tonight, Lord, and we're believing you, Lord, for things that we don't see the result, but we're believing you by faith. And so we lift up and continue to lift up our banister to you, Lord. And Lord, and we lift up those, Lord, that the doctors have just said, Angie Stanley and different others, Lord, that they don't know. I lift up Anita, Lord, they say they don't know, but you know. And so, Lord, we trust you to do what only you can do. And so we pray believing in faith, and we say yes and amen to the finished work of the Holy Spirit in these matters. Lord, we pray for jobs, for those that are needing jobs. And then, Lord, we pray, Lord, for the work, Lord, in New York as men prepare to go, Lord, in the next few weeks, Lord, to labor there for that ministry that is touching the world and touching the Jewish community. We ask, Lord, that you would use us to touch the world, as well as Canton and Fulton County. Go with us, be with us. Strengthen us, Lord, and may we give you all praise and give you all glory. May we truly be encouragers to one another for the complete work of the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name.